Hello and welcome to NewsClick's International Roundup. Today, we'll be discussing developments in the situation in Syria and North Korea. We have with us Prabir Purkayastha, Editor-in-Chief NewsClick. Hello, Prabir. Prabir, let's start with the situation in Syria. The latest round of the Astana talks were held in the Russian city of Sochi and is being held at a very interesting juncture because the Assad government has also made certain military advances. And Russia, Iran and Turkey have been the key countries. So how do you see the key developments? What have been the key developments that have taken place in these talks, and how do you see the way ahead?
I think the most important part to realize is the action has moved to what used to be the talks that were held under UN aegis earlier. The United States, the European powers are a party to it. And now it's essentially being done by parties directly involved in Syria. And it does not involve the United States. I think that's a huge change in the international scenario. As we know, US is still deeply involved because it is supporting the Kurdish forces east of Euphrates. It is in fact intervened on a couple of occasions, even militarily. So it is not that the US game plan is over in Syria. But nevertheless, it also shows its weakening influence, being able to determine the course of other major actors. So I think that's the biggest takeaway, that decisive shift has now taken place on the issue of Syria and probably including other parts of West Asia as well. As far as the discussions in this time in Sochi is concerned, I think it's also interesting to see how militarily the situation has changed completely. I think this has been the fastest advance the Syrian forces have had and in Syria for the last 2 years. So this is also showing that the decisive balance of forces is now in favor of Bashar al-Assad's government. So that shows also in the way the opposition has split and has essentially, most of them have essentially laid down arms. Some of them even have joined the Syrian army. And some of them actually took arms against the ISIS forces and managed to both fight against them, and also the joint operation resulted in some of the ISIS forces who had decided to make a last stand being actually caught and put hopefully in prison currently. It's also interesting that this is bordering Golan. So Israel has kept out of the battle. It did not do as it frequently does, support the Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and other, the so-called Free Syrian Army forces by coming to their aid indirectly through artillery shelling, use of air power, and so on. So this has been a very, very decisive shift militarily. Now the question comes up, there is east of Euphrates, there is the US and SDF forces, and on the north you have Idlib. It does appear that before we come to Idlib, we should also look at what is happening in the Kurdish forces. The SDF has started talking to Bashar al-Assad's government. So there is this issue that maybe the US is going to withdraw out of Syria completely. And that is the reason they're also not hindering the discussions that are taking place between SDF and Bashar al-Assad's government. So it's possible that the SDF will concede the borders and agree to be a part of Syria and not declare itself an independent Kurdish state. And if that happens, then what do the Turks do? What does Turkey do becomes the essential issue. And that's what's playing out in Idlib. So you have this contradictory international forces there with one or the other, depending on the specific sector. So the United States with the SDF against Assad. But if SDF talks to Assad, then what happens? US is against Turkey with the Kurdish forces. But if the Kurds also work out an agreement with Bashar al-Assad's government, what does US do then? Does it make up to Turkey, make up with Turkey, and say, now your enemy is also my enemy? Do they also try to help Turkey in Idlib? Looking at all these issues, it doesn't appear that Idlib is something that the Turks can continue to keep. And it does seem that its position has weakened. It's unlikely that US will support Turkey or Turkey will seek US support. That doesn't seem to be also happening because they do feel that the US sided with the Kurdish forces, and that's something which is a big no-no for them. They may have historical claims, but as you know, everybody has historical claims on the neighbor. So that's not something which is new. After all, it's a part of the decolonization as well as a colonization which creates this kind of historical claims. Turkey's position at the moment in Idlib is it's supported by anything from 30 to 50,000 troops who are from ISIS to Al-Qaeda to various other Al-Qaeda light forces, and also some of the Islamist groups over there seem to owe allegiance directly to Turkey and a part of the Turkmen forces over there. Let's not also forget there are something like anything between 12 to 20,000 guest fighters, Chechens, other groups from Caucasus, also from different parts of the world, probably some from Saudi Arabia as well. So there's a huge number of so-called guest fighters over there, and they are the ones who are most likely to fight till the last. So this is the issue that Turkey has. How does it live up to its commitments, which was to, as a part of the de-escalation zone, in which Idlib was Turkey's responsibility, it is supposed to have got the militants to lay down arms or to fight against them. It has done neither. So as Bashar al-Jafri,
ambassador to the
United Nations, who led the Syrian delegation, has said, de-escalation zones are not forever. There are some guarantees which are given that we will not enter those places, but it's also based on the fact that those who had the de-escalation responsibilities, they had to disarm the militants, which they haven't done. So this cannot continue, and essentially he has said we are going to take back Idlib. Russia has said we'll have to see, we hope this can be resolved amicably. We're talking to Turkey, we're talking to Syria, but Idlib has become the new, shall we say, contestation between Turkey and a more assertive Syria now that it has won decisively in the south. Last point over this is, what is Russia's game plan over here? Russia would like good relations with Turkey, would like Syria to take back the territory it has at the moment, which is under Turkish control or in the hands of different militant groups. The so-called de-escalation zone is a set of checkpoints Turkey has set up, but it is not that it is controlling the rest of the territory. So with this issue, Russia's game plan is to do what it seems to have done also in other parts of Syria, which is to help the process of getting the Syrian forces and those who are opposed to Syria to talk to each other and work out a de-escalation, which is essentially laying down of arms, integrating themselves within the Syrian army, at best a amnesty, all of this put together. And this way of handling it seems to have worked in Syria. To this extent, the American, shall we say, model of control of Iraq, Afghanistan has clearly failed. Afghanistan, they're at the point at the moment talking about withdrawing from it. So all of this shows the Russian model of actually talking and trying to get a reapproachment without bothering about who their mentors are, what their interest is, but can we get local groups to talk to each other and then accept Syrian government's control. I think that is the policy it will also follow in Idlib. Split the groups, each, as you know, there are about 50 odd groups over there. They're also killing each other, they're fighting each other. So given this, it may be possible that they can continue to work this out and isolate Turkey. And Turkey does not have too many cards at the moment in the game. Having burnt its bridges to the United States, particularly after the coup and the Gulen affair, in which they're asking Gulen's return, and it's quite possible that the priest, that the Christian missionary,
who's been held by the Turkish. Sanctions were imposed on Turkey recently. Yes.
That Christian missionary's attempt was to really keep holding him was an attempt to get Gulen back. to work out a barter. That hasn't worked, is in fact has backfired on Turkey because US has now imposed sanctions. Now, whatever way we look at it, whether we like sanctions as an instrument of foreign policy or not, Turkey doesn't seem to have too many cards. So I do think that it may be a matter of 3 months, 6 months. But I think Idlib finally will come back to Syria. And I also think the east of Euphrates, which is the other area, which is about 25 to 30% of the country, which the Kurds have taken under US umbrella, that will also integrate back to Syria with some more autonomy given to the Kurdish areas, because that area also includes a lot of other Arab people. And it is not just Kurdish area, it is also Armenian presence, various other groups of ethnic identities are there. So I think what we are seeing is a victory for Bashar al-Assad, which in the next 6 months to 12 months will see some semblance of unity in Syria again. And this is good for Europe as well, because it means that Syrian refugees can come back. And I think that is a big, big burden on all the neighboring countries. The bulk of it has been borne by Jordan and Turkey. So I think this is in everybody's interest now, now that Assad has won decisively, that not to prolong Syria's agony, but let it now come to a state where it can act again as a state which has to look after civic responsibilities. And I think this is what everybody should be helping. And I hope the United States will not play the spoiler, which is what it has done till now in most of these cases.
So basically what we are seeing is also, especially once, for instance, like you said, Idlib returns to the government control, the formal burial of the regime change plan that began nearly 7 years ago. Because even though the opposition continues to insist on it, I don't think it is actually any more serious takers anymore, as far as players are concerned.
I think the US has also conceded for the last 6 months that they have lost the game in Syria. So I think the official burial might not have been given to it, but a more or less tacit burial has been given by the various spokespersons speaking on this issue. So they might still say Assad must go and he is this and he is that. But the reality is they are recognizing on the ground that this is a lost case.
So Prabir, moving on to North Korea. So in North Korea, we have a series of strange developments, if you can call it that. So on the one hand, for instance, the bodies of the 55 US soldiers were returned by North Korea to the United States yesterday. At the same time, I think you can see at least parts of the establishment through the media talking about the missiles again being developed in certain sites. And there's this whole bogey of nuclearization which is being raised again. So how do we see the situation right now when on the face of it, things are proceeding as planned? And even North Korea and South Korea are planning their exchange of the families, reuniting of families also next month. But at the same time, you have series sections of the establishment in the United States especially trying to derail the deal again.
Well, you know that Pompeo and Bolton are the two people, part of the White House current presidential entourage, who are deeply hostile, shall we say, to the North Korean or DPRK's peace accord and what Trump and Kim had negotiated. So they have from the beginning made no bones that this is something that they don't really like. And Bolton has always argued that the issue is not what we do, issue is what North Korea does. It must give up everything before we will do anything. This is basically what the situation for him is. Now, Trump did, of course, do one thing after the agreement. He stopped the military exercises, which North Korea had always said is a pro quid pro for any peace talks, because they had suspended missile tests, they had some suspended nuclear tests, and having done it unilaterally, they had said, you must also stop the exercises. Earlier, they were linking this, they made it sequential. And Trump did reciprocate after the Singapore discussions, and he came back and stopped the exercises. Now, what are the next step? If you go by the agreement that has been reached, and this is 1, 2, 3, 4. One is essentially normalization of relations. South Korea and North Korea are doing it. There is no, as of now, there is no indication what is US's position on this, right, how they propose to normalize the relations. Now, the abnormality of the relations is, of course, also can be seen from the fact there is only an armistice, there is no peace agreement in Korea. So they technically are still at war. So how do they do that? Do they do that as step one or step two? The step two was essentially a peace agreement in the Korean Peninsula. So do they do that? That's the question that still remains. As a first step towards normalization, military exercises have stopped. But normalization is a process. It is not a step. So how does normalization takes place? What is the route map for this? We have to see. Now, this is what the two countries should be discussing, and probably also with South Korea, who is the other key player involved, how this normalization process takes place, and maybe at some point draw also China and Russia, who are the littoral states, next door states to North Korea, into this. The second point in that agreement is a peace accord, the Korean Peninsula must be at peace, which means move from armistice to a formal peace agreement. Now, this again, a roadmap has to be there. I don't see any of those things taking place as of now, or United States being willing to discuss these issues. While the third point, and it is a sequential one, two, three, was denuclearization of the peninsula. And this is the only thing Americans want to discuss, and that too, denuclearization of the peninsula. Now, it's also an important thing. Of course, they have also talked of demilitarization. It's also important to realize that while none of these things have happened, there is no obligation on North Koreans to either stop any military developments, including missiles, or including, say, installing more centrifuges. They can do goodwill gestures, which they have done. They have dismantled parts of the test site, which means that they don't intend to test in the near future. They have done only those steps which are already in the pipeline. That means they are building some factories, they're building some facilities. They have not discontinued them. They want to complete them. Any stepping back from these can take place only as a part of a larger demilitarization, denuclearization exercise. Missiles are never in this agreement. They have never been mentioned in the agreement. If at all they come in, the denuclearization, demilitarization of the peninsula discussions, it may come in at some stage. But it will also mean a whole lot of gestures on the United States part, who discusses Korean Peninsula not as a matter of Korean Peninsula, but as a theater of war of the United States. So it is talking about that region and how the US security interest in that region must be protected. Now, US security interest in the region, it's actually near Russia, China, and Japan. What is US security interest? And why is that have other countries have given, shall we say, this on to have the offered that you protect our security interests? Who are these countries? So those are the questions that have to be related. I can understand if Japan says that we need the United States, we want to be a party to these discussions. I can understand the locus of that. But the locus of US claiming security interests in the borders of other countries, China, Russia, of course, North Korea, is difficult to understand straight off. Yes, South Korea has obvious security interests, but they seem to be willing to work this out. So this whole issue of that is being whipped up, and US media is very much complicit of this. There's Washington Post, there's New York Times, they're all carrying op-eds, claiming military sources, intelligence sources, without naming them, and talking about how North Koreans have been deceiving the United States with assurances which they're not keeping. No such assurances have been given. There's nothing in the agreement which says they have to stop all of this. There's nothing on the agreement which says they have to stop all missile developments. All they have done unilaterally is missile tests and nuclear tests. And that's it, nothing more. And that's purely as a goodwill gesture. If this has to continue, it's also true this has to be negotiated further. And I don't think North Koreans have ever put missile developments on the table. Yes, if you talk of ICBM development, you may say no tests, you can do laboratory developments, design developments, but you can't test them. That is something it can be negotiated. But to claim that they can't put up a shed without permission from the United States is a very far cry from what both sides have agreed. So the question really is, why is it happening? Clearly there are sections in the United States which would like the North Korean agreement to break. Let's not forget, Bolton did want the earlier agreement to break, and in fact crowed over the fact that we could take a sledgehammer to the Korean agreement because they had started uranium enrichment, which again was not banned on the earlier agreement, but they could use it to dismantle the whole agreement. Now, this is the second time Bolton might still try and play that role, how to sabotage this agreement. Now, whether Trump is using all of this to build up pressure on North Korea, on Kim, to basically try and soften him up, is this a matter of gamemanship? We have to see. How much of Trump is bluff and bluster, how much of it is real, we don't know. But it is true that in the spirit of what the Singapore agreement was, if we take that into account, then Trump genuinely wanted to reset the relations with North Korea and reset what appeared to be heading for a military confrontation with dire consequences for everybody. And I think that reset we will probably tend to see unless Trump weakens much more in the United States. Of course, all of the things that are happening, the Mueller indictments, trying to call him somebody who's a traitor to the United States for not listening to the intelligence reports, and so on. Now, this is domestic politics of the United States, in which the whole world has a stake, but at the same time has no control. So this is something we can keep on discussing till end of time. The reality is, at the moment, what is impinging on international relations is US domestic politics. And that, as we have always said, is the reason that the world peace is hostage to a minority of people in the United States. Because as you know, the voting percentages in the US are pretty low, it's about 50%. But so even a majority of this 50% is actually very small, is a minority in the United States. But entire international politics of the globe, and these are really matters of life and death, because it is nuclear weapons. All of this is at the moment held hostage to this minority politics of the United States.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching NewsClick.